Hey everyone, Tipane here from the Developer Advocacy Team at Zendesk. Recently, we released a video about the basics of using webhooks at Zendesk. While webhooks have been a great improvement over HTTP targets in areas such as security and logging, we received a bunch of really good feedback from users looking to expand their toolset when using webhooks. Today, we're super excited to introduce a new way to utilize webhooks at Zendesk through user and organization events. In the past, the only way to prompt a webhook to fire was by setting up a trigger or automation in Zendesk support and executing the webhook as an action. With this new release, we'll be able to bypass the support business rules and trigger a webhook to fire directly off of Zendesk events. Let's take a look at an example of what that might look like. Say you want to sync data to a third-party service when a new organization is created in your Zendesk account. Previously, you'd need to make a call to the API and directly pull the data whenever a new org was created. Now, you can set up a webhook that subscribes to the organization creation event, which will automatically send the data as a HTTP post request to the URL that you specify. This workflow simplifies the development of apps and integrations by allowing you to sync data with and trigger actions in systems outside of Zendesk. One thing to note, existing webhooks will continue to function as they do today, and you'll be able to continue creating webhooks based on support business rules. But if you have existing webhooks that you'd like to subscribe to events, you'll need to create a new webhook to do that. Okay, with that covered, let's take a look at how we can set up a webhook in Zendesk with user and organization events. Here's a scenario. Imagine for a moment that you manage a Zendesk account where new users are being created many times throughout the day, and you need these records to be kept in sync with an external database. What's the best way to go about this? Well, up until now, it's been by polling our APIs to identify user creation events. Now, you can set up webhooks to send these notifications directly in response to user and organization events. Let's go ahead and set up an example where we'll create a webhook that subscribes to the support user created event. We'll also create a basic Google app script that will receive the data and populate a Google sheet when the user information is sent from our webhook. In Admin Center, we'll go ahead and click the apps and integrations dropdown in the left-hand side panel and select webhooks. If this is your first time opening the webhooks page, you'll see the Getting Started page, which outlines creating a webhook and converting HTTP targets to webhooks. If you're seeing the Getting Started page, go ahead and click Create Webhook at the bottom. Otherwise, select Create Webhook. Now, if you've watched our previous video on the basics of webhooks, or if you're already familiar with Zendesk webhooks, the first thing you'll immediately notice is that you now have two options to connect: Zendesk Events and Trigger or Automation. For the purposes of this video, we'll be sticking to Zendesk Events. If you'd like to learn more about using webhooks together with support business rules, I've linked the previous video above, which will get you up to speed. With the Zendesk Events option selected, you'll see a drop-down menu to select one or more event types. This is where you'll see all of the events that can currently be subscribed to when creating your webhook, as well as their description. As you can see, there are a ton of different options to choose from, depending on your use case. Since we want to be notified when a new user is created, we'll go ahead and select the Support User Created event. If you want to learn more about the different event types available, I'll drop a link to the documentation in the description below that goes into more detail. For now, we'll click Next at the bottom right, which will bring us to the webhook configuration page. This is where we'll enter all the required information for our webhook, such as name, endpoint URL, and authentication. If you've worked with Zendesk webhooks in the past, this page should look a bit more familiar to you. Let's start by entering a name for our webhook, which we'll go ahead and call User Database Sync. Next, we'll add a description. This is an optional field, but it's a great way to keep track of what each webhook is doing. We'll go ahead and add that description here now. Next up, we'll add our endpoint URL. This is the URL that the webhook will send the HTTP request to when the specified event takes place. In our case, we'll need to generate the URL once we have deployed our Google App script, so for now, we'll enter an example URL here until we've set up the script. One thing to note with endpoint URLs, support placeholders will only be interpolated for webhooks which are connected to a trigger or automation. This means that placeholders cannot be used in the endpoint URL of webhooks set up to connect to Zendesk events. Okay, next up we have the request method and request format, and you might notice that these two fields have been disabled. For webhooks that subscribe to Zendesk events, the request method and format is fixed as a post request with a JSON format. Finally, we have authentication for our webhook. Here, you'll see three options that webhooks support: no authentication, basic authentication, and bearer token. Basic authentication takes a username and password, which will be provided by the third-party service you're interacting with. Bearer token is where you'll enter an OAuth access token to authenticate the webhook if a third-party service is secured using OAuth. The endpoint you're interacting with will determine the type of authentication you should be using here. In this example, our Google App script will be available to all users, so we can leave none selected. Webhooks also provide an additional layer of security verification in the form of signing secrets. These signing secrets are automatically included in the webhook request headers and can be used to verify against a secret key that is available in the webhook details page or via the API. While optional, verifying signing secrets is a useful tool for ensuring the authenticity of requests made to your endpoint. If you'd like to learn more about verifying webhook authenticity using signing secrets, I've dropped a link in the description below. Okay, now that we've entered all the required information, next up is testing the webhook. But before we can do that, we'll need to set up our external service to handle the HTTP request. Let's head over and set up our Google App script. Google App script is a cloud-based JavaScript platform that lets you integrate with and automate tasks across Google products. We'll be using the service to create a simple app that ingests the HTTP request sent by our webhook, parses the data, and populates the user info to a Google Sheet. If you're not familiar with Google App script and would like to learn more, I put a link to the documentation in the description below to get you started. Okay, so I've gone ahead and created a spreadsheet ahead of time called User Database. This is where our user information will be stored. For our spreadsheet to be accessible to the app script, we'll need to update the share permissions. At the top right, click the share icon. We'll need to set the general access to anyone with the link, so if you see restricted on your end, go ahead and update that now. Next, we'll click Extensions in the top toolbar and select Apps Script. This brings us to the Google App Script Editor. Here, you'll see we're in a file named code.js, which contains an empty function named myFunction. Right now, this doesn't do much, so let's go ahead and update the code. First, we'll want to update the function name to doPost. This lets the app know to expect a post request and run the function when it is received. The doPost function takes an event parameter which will contain the JSON body of the request sent from our webhook. Inside the doPost function, the first thing we'll do is create a variable and assign it the spreadsheet we'll be using to store our data. We can do that by using the spreadsheet app.openById method, which is provided by the spreadsheet service within Google App Script. The method takes in a spreadsheet ID as an argument, so we'll head back to our spreadsheet, grab the ID from the URL at the top, and paste that into our function call. Next, we'll need to get the specific sheet we'll be working with. In our case, we have a sheet named User Database, so we'll go ahead and call the getSheetByName method against our spreadsheet variable, and pass it User Database as an argument. Now, if we were to try and access the data in the event parameter directly, we'd run into an error since Google App Script returns the content in a string format. So, what we'll need to do next is use the JSON.parse method to convert the data into a usable format. Let's go ahead and create a variable named data, which will be assigned the value returned from JSON.parse. We'll pass in e.postdata.contents as the argument, which will return exactly the request body sent from our webhook. Next, we'll need to define the values that are used to populate our spreadsheet. In this example, we'll create an array that contains two more arrays. The first array will list the column titles that will live on row 1. The second array will contain a selection of values from our data variable that will live on row 2 and subsequent rows if we have multiple users. Next, we'll define a variable called lastRow that gets the last row in our sheet that has content. Finally, we'll create an if-else statement that we'll use to set the data in our sheet. First, we'll check if the spreadsheet is empty based on the last row variable we just defined. If it's empty, we'll call the getRange and setValues methods against our sheet variable. The getRange method is used to define where in our sheet we'll be adding the data. There's a few different ways you can define this. In our case, the first two numbers describe the row and column to start inserting the data. The second two numbers describe how many rows and columns our data will require. The setValues method is used to insert the data based on the dimensions we described in the setRange method. This takes one argument, which in our case will be the values array we defined earlier. Now, If we're adding more than one user to our spreadsheet, we don't want the column titles in our values array to be added each time. So we'll add an else condition to execute if the last row value is equal to or greater than 1. We'll be using the getRange and setValues methods here as well, but this time we'll update the arguments passed to getRange to only set one row of data, and we'll update the values passed to setValues to use only the second array item which contains our user data. So we can see the data in the response body when we test our webhook. We should also add a return value here as well. Let's add the contentService.createTextOutput method and pass it the event parameter inside a json.stringify method. Now, remember when we configured our webhook and used a placeholder endpoint URL? Let's go ahead and generate a usable URL now so we can test this out. First thing we'll need to do is deploy our app, so at the top right of the screen, go ahead and click the deploy button and select new deployment. We'll need to deploy this as a web app, so if it isn't selected already, click the settings cog next to select type and click web app. Next, we'll add a description. For the purposes of this walkthrough, we can select me to execute the app. Lastly, we'll select anyone as the access type. Click the deploy button at the bottom right, and you may be prompted to authorize access to the app. Go ahead and follow the prompts until the app has been appropriately authorized. If everything went well, we should see the successful deployment of our app with a web app URL generated at the bottom. This is a URL we'll be using in our webhook configuration page, so let's copy the link and head back over to our webhook config page. Under endpoint URL, replace the example URL we entered earlier with the web app URL we just generated. Now, let's go ahead and test our webhook. Click the Test Webhook button at the bottom of the configuration page, and you'll see the Test Webhook panel appear to the right of your screen. The first option you'll have is to choose the event type. As mentioned earlier, a single webhook can subscribe to multiple user and organization events. This field allows us to choose the event subscription we'd like to test. In our case, we're subscribed to the Support User Created event only, so we'll leave this as is. Below, we also have a request body. This is the JSON payload that will be sent in our test request. By default, the request body is populated with a mock payload. You can make changes to this if you like, just be sure to follow the correct format for the event you're testing if you'd like the results to be accurate at the destination endpoint. One thing to note, if you're using signature verification and testing the webhook before it has been fully created, you'll need to use a static signing secret. I've included a link in the description below where you'll be able to find this. Once the webhook is successfully created, a unique secret key will be generated which can then be used for verification. Okay, with that covered, let's go ahead and test our webhook. We'll click the Send Test button, and if everything went well, we should see a 200 OK status, along with the text response we returned in the app script. You'll also see the Response Headers tab, which contains the headers returned with the response. Now, if we switch over to our spreadsheet, we should also see our data being populated to the sheet successfully. If we send another test, we'll also see the subsequent user data being populated correctly, as we defined in the if-else statement in our app script. Okay, now that we've tested our webhook and confirmed everything is working as expected, let's go ahead and complete the setup by clicking the Create Webhook button at the bottom right of the screen. Now, on the main webhook screen, you'll see the webhook we just created, along with the endpoint URL and status. As with webhooks created using support business rules, you can edit, test, and view the details of your webhook by clicking the options icon to the right of the status indicator. Next, let's try out the webhook with real users. We'll head over to our Zendesk instance, hover over the Add button at the top, and select User. Here, we'll enter a name, email, and brand, as well as the user type. Next, we'll click Add, and we should see the user successfully created. Now, if we head over to our sheet, we'll see the user details added. We can confirm it is the same user by comparing the user ID in the sheet to the user ID in the URL of the profile page in Zendesk. And last but not least, once you're done experimenting with webhook events and the Google app script we've created, I'd encourage you to update the access privileges of the script to avoid anyone inadvertently accessing it in the future. And that wraps up the introduction to using webhooks together with user and organization events in Zendesk. Webhooks are a great tool to communicate with external systems, and with this new release, you'll now be able to streamline these integrations by subscribing directly to Zendesk Events. We're incredibly excited with this new update to the Webhook Toolkit, And while we only covered one event type in this video, there's a full suite of user and organization events available, so I'd encourage you to try these out, as well as experimenting with subscribing to multiple events. If you'd like to learn more about the different event types available today, I've left a link in the description below that'll get you started. We'll also be looking to incrementally add support for different event types in future, so watch this space. As always, if there's anything else you'd like us to cover in future videos, please leave a comment below. Thanks so much for watching, and see you in the next one.